Again, good afternoon, everyone. I'm planning on today to wrap this up and just show you what we actually do here at Edison in our manufacturing course, the lathe work, the mill work. I'm going to show you a little bit more CNC. We'll wrap that up, and I'm also going to show you where I take our several field trips, or where we take our several field trips. So we're still looking at the CTAG, all right, for the manufacturing processes, mainly the objective number two, finishing. So really it's just basic machining. Going to talk about turning and boring in this section, and at the end of this section, I'm going to show you some projects we actually do here at Edison. So basic turning, I want people to start understanding really what happens during the cutting processes. Various nomenclature in the green, you do see a video that I've got for turning in the lathe. I think just to save some time, I won't be showing all those today, but the link will be there. Very good videos. Again, you know what turning is, what the turning processes are, and what's the three factors in determining basic turning. We've already referred to the cutting speed and the feed and the depth of cut. So this video really shows a lot of that. With that, we're talking about the different types of major groups of turning machines, the engine lathe, the turret lathe, screw machines, the boring mill vertical, and then the automatic lathes. And then I get involved with the components of the engine lathe, the headstock, the tailstock, the bed, the carriage, the cross slide, and the compound rest. Then we talk about engine lathe sizes, how we determine the lathe size. You know, it's given by the maximum diameter of the swing in inches, the maximum length of the bar that can be turned between centers. And I sort of stress the B is not, you do not include what you can overhang on the tailstock. That's not really supposed to be permissible. It's just about as far as you can go back in the bed, your distance in between centers. I do have a picture of a engine lathe. The company I used to work for, we had 26 feet between centers, and we did have one engine lathe that we had a 60-inch diameter, and it was 20 feet between centers. And they actually saw this in one of our field trips. So we talked about the carriage and the different work tool holding devices. We actually use both here as far as the tool post, the various tool posts. Talked about the compound, the cross slide, the saddle, the apron, the half nut lever. Of course, we'll be using that for the threading, the different power feed hand and the carriage hand wheels. When I start this lab and we go out there and lathe, I have five lathes that we actually got a bar across the bottom of the lathe. If something happens, you kick that bar and the lathe will just shut off exactly right now. My other large lathe, that doesn't happen. But I let them go through, not cutting anything, but they turn the chuck on. They'll get the feeds going. They'll get the cross feed going and then the carriage feed going. We'll explain, again, the various parts of the engine lathe, how to change the feed inches per minute, and again, how to change the RPM. So they get a little bit of that opportunity, just get the feel of the engine lathe. Talk a little bit about the tailstock, and again, the purpose of the tailstock, the different components of the tailstock. And again, we also talk about the dead center versus a live center, and I have both of those out there. When we actually start our engine lathe lab work, we do use live centers. I tell them the issues that we have with the dead centers about overheating, etc. Then reaming operation, lathe work holding methods. We talk about lathe centers. And again, as I said, the live and dead center. We talked about the different chucks, the three jaw, the four jaw, the collet chuck. I believe you might see some pictures here after a bit. And again, I have a video on that. Talk about the advantages and disadvantages of the various chucks. The face plate. Again, using a mandrel, and then the work supports, the center rest, the steady rest, the follower rest. So, again, just some pictures looking at the three jaw and the four jaw, the collet, the face plate, and just the various setups that you may see on an engine lathe. We'll talk about knurling here after a bit. and again, the various mandrels that you may be able to use out in industry. We do have collets out there. Mainly in my lab, we use a three-jaw chuck. I do have one assignment where they have to use the four-jaw to indicate a part in. I want them to get used to indicating using a Sterrett 196 indicator. Just another example of an engine lathe, and again, the various components. And how large can we go? Again, this is a lot larger than what I used to work on, but this shows them, and they ask me, well, how do they really measure that? And I said, well, there's several ways. I don't think I've seen that outside micrometer, but we actually use a pie tape. I don't know if you've ever heard of that, but it's actually just a tape that you wrap around and get it tight, and you can measure that. It's supposed to be within a thousandth of an inch. And I have a pie tape out in our lab. Turnt lathe, we again have a video to show this, but I explain the differences between a turnt lathe and an engine lathe. This is mainly for a more of a high production machine when you've got multiple quantities versus just one or two. You can set that up using the turrets. I talked a little bit about the turnt stops, how you can set those up for your lengths. Again, the square turnt for the tool post. And again, the hex turnt that you can put various tools in the turnt itself. Showing the turnt again, how it works. Another picture, ram type turnt lathe. This is what you see in a lot of industries about this size, maybe a little bit bigger, but I've seen, especially a lot of job shops, I've seen quite a few people have these. I used to send work outside the company I worked for, and this is what they would have. Vertical turning center. We go to Mr. Machine, they actually see one like this. Talk a little bit about sometimes they'll have different tool post here than a tool post over here at the side. And sometimes you can actually see them using both of these tool posts at once for the chuck revolution. And this is what I end up doing in the class. I asked them, I said, I'd like for you to draw me a sketch of straight turning, face turning. And they draw me a sketch. I want them to visualize what's going on. And again, later I will show them some pictures, see how close that they came to what their sketch looked like. And then we just talked about various facing, turning, profiling in the lathe operations, knurling, drilling, counterboring, boring, cutoff, slotting, and of course, chasing threads. Straight turning, taper turning, contour turning, forming. Necking or grooving, and then parting and cutting off. They do, you'll see in my lab, you'll see one part that they actually cut off. Straight boring to taper boring. Knurling, drilling. And again, showing the various tools, the left-hand cutting tool, right-hand cutting tool, round nose turning tool, threading tool, facing tool. One thing that as I'm looking at this tools, I give them a high-speed tool, and I ask them to take it out on a pedestal grinder and grind it. because that's what they're going to be using for their lathe project. And what's interesting is I have to, you know, I show them the proper clearances, et cetera, so on and so forth. And I want them to get used of the lip angle, the cutting angles, et cetera, so on and so forth. That we're just cutting aluminum. Generally, as long as they got some clearance, then we're okay. I try to have them grind a threading tool, which is 60 degrees. That takes a little bit of time, and sometimes I just run out, so I end up having those myself. I grind those myself. They do chase threads on Ninja-Lite. And again, it's a real good slide on the various operations: parting, external threading, turning, facing, taper, knurling, grooving, cutting a radius, how we end up doing that, or cutting a bevel, ID threading, forming tools, and again, cutting. Left hand, there's your right, left hand, right hand. And again, left hand, right hand. I have a video that actually shows some of this. Different processes, chamfering, face grooving. And why I'm at this, we talk a little bit about safety on here also. I talk about you need to watch the chips as they come off. You know, it's not very safe to grab a hold of that, especially with your hand. And we have pliers out there that we use, or tongs. But again, mainly all we cut is aluminum. But they still get a curl chip. Talk about taper turning. And these are the tapers general out in industry, the Morse taper per foot, the Brown and Sharp, the purpose mill spindles and shanks, the Jarno taper, lay the mill spindles, 600 taper per foot, sellers for sellers equipment, and taper pins is 250,000 taper per foot. And again, you have those in various lengths and diameters. That is actually a test question that I use here, and it's usually matching. And how do we cut taper on Ninja-Lite? Well, there's three ways. We talked about the tailstock setover. And again, this time I'm showing them in between centers with the lathe dog. We can do the compound rest, and then we have a taper attachment. All the lathes out there have a taper attachment. The one project I have them do, they actually have to cut a taper. I talk about the advantages and disadvantages. Especially if you use the tailstock setover, the issue that you have is that you got to put the tailstock back on center, and that takes some time sometimes because you got to cut apart, measure it, and see if you have to adjust it. So usually, we don't do this out in the lab at all. We just use the tailstock setover or the compound. And of course, using a tool, forming tool. Okay, again, looking at the chucks, various setups on the chuck using the OD or the ID. Talk a little bit about these rings going around, how that will help you up set it up a little quicker, especially with the four jaw. Three jaw. Again, we talked about this, that these jaws are marked, so you have to make sure that you put it in the right slot. Knurling tools, and again, one project that we do out there, we do knurl. Diamond. Boring and facing operations. And again, showing the setup in between centers. Threading. We actually chase threads out there on the lathe. Talk about the proper using the centering gauge, setting your tool up, setting the compound at 29 degrees or 29.5 degrees. make sure you have your headstock set where it's supposed to be for the threads per inch. And again, how we use the half nut lever. We cut 3/8, 16, and 1/2 inch diameter threads for their project. There's some videos, and again, it's available. There's a basic metal lathe safety, machine tool basics, lathe cutting tools, fundamental manufacturing processes as far as tooling, cutting tool design, cutting tool geometries, and then here's the Warner Swayze, the one I just talked about. Talks about the turn lathe operation, the industrial, this industrial accident. Let's watch that real quick. This is not very long. This gentleman gets wrapped up. The issue, no safety glasses, long sleeves. And again, they get him off of there. I had another one that I used to have, but it showed a lot of blood. I don't show that anymore. But, you know, they get him off of there, and we just show, you know, how dangerous this equipment can be. Oop, I'm going to go back here again. Okay. And again, drilling large diameter holes on a lathe, really nice videos. All right, then we go to drilling and reaming and related processes. There's some more fundamentals of processes in drilling. There's a crash course in milling, which we cover in Chapter 9, and tapping. And again, those videos are available. You have to just hit the link. Talk about the drilling process, what we're doing as far as the production, enlarging holes, the various methods of drilling, conventional deep hole and small hole drilling, and then the choice really depends on the size, your depth, the tolerance that you need to hold, and what's the finish required. Talk a little bit about the different taper shanks, straight shanks, and again, of course, the jobber's length, which is a standard drill. Helix angles, various terms. I do have a question, and I think you'll see it here in a moment, about the lip angles. And again, they're classified by the material they're made out of, whether high speed or carbide, kind of shank, and the number of flutes, whether single, two, or three or four flute, which are core drills. The length, the diameter, and then the point geometry. And again, the shank, whether it's straight or tapered. Drill sizes, numerical, alphabetical, fractional, and millimeter. Generally, those are the standard ranges. Start showing a little bit of different type drills, step drills, etc., subland drills, the purpose. Special purpose drills. just even as I'm just looking at this, I don't think I've ever seen a left-hand drill. They're out there. Talk about drill sizes and tab drill sizes. And as I mentioned before, it's an option. It's not required, but I like to see the students purchase a machinery handbook. And then, as I've said before, when you purchase the handbook, you actually get a CD with it. And I believe they're in a 29th edition right now. I have the 28th. Drill point geometry. Again, if the standard drill is 118, a 90 degree included lip angle is for soft material, and then 135 degree is lip angle is used for very hard materials. And what's interesting here is that this is something else I will do is I want them to practice sharpening a drill. And generally I say, if you have any drills at home, bring them in and you know we'll let you sharpen them. Well, probably 75% of the time I end up sharpening them. Drilling operations, reaming, tapping, counterboring, countersinking, centering, spot facing. And I talk about the different applications for each one. It's, you know, the spot facing on a boss, reaming, proper allowance that you would use, 12 to 15 thousandths allowance. And I believe this slide here, these pictures here, I use for a test question, matching again. Some more pictures showing the related processes. Different type drilling tools. I don't know how many have seen a circle color cutter, but I really like it. I have one at my in my toolbox at home. We have one out here. There's just various things that you can do with it, especially if you're just cutting small plate or something. Just listen to this. And then it's out of balance. Stay drilling. I have several of the spade drills out there. And various drill presses. Radial drill, freestanding drill press. We have this out in the lab, the freestanding. And we talk about gang drilling. And again, this shows a gang drilling machine and Dexpool machine.
Hey, Steve.
Yes.
Yeah. Can you just do an audio check? I had a funny audio thing in my speakers.
Yeah, I'm hearing it too.
Yeah, and I ended up losing you, so I ended up calling in on the phone. I can hear you well on the phone, but over the speaker thing, I can't hear you at all.
Okay, just a minute.
Maybe we check just to make sure those guys. I just sent a chat, but.
Yeah, I lost it for a while, but got it back.
You got me back?
Yeah.
Okay, great.
Yeah, same with me. I lost you for a little bit, but you're back.
All right. Well, okay. I wonder if something happened with my system here, because I ended up shutting my speakers off and no problem. I'll just go back to mute on my telephone. So I'm hearing you fine, too, and seeing you as well. So.
Okay.
All right, thanks a lot.
I think I'm hearing drilling now. It's interesting. I'm hearing music. I don't know where it's come from.
Oh, really? Yeah, I'm not hearing. I mean, I'm hearing you very well, but nothing else.
Nobody's hearing music?
No, sir.
Okay.
I hear background noise. Sounds like your old-fashioned
radio. There's a video that I just, again, the gang drilling indexing machine.
Okay.
Talk about the advantages of this during mechanical versus CNC. Reamers. And again, the purpose, the allowance generally we use for stock to ream. We talked a little bit about the micro finishes. Show them the reamer itself. Again, we talk about the appropriate stock removal and the various types, adjustable reamers. And again, straight flute, spiral flute. Then we get in threads. Talking about screw thread, various destinations of a screw thread, the pitch, the angle of the thread, major diameter, pitch diameter. And we actually get the machinist handbook out. We talked about that, how we inspect threads. Talking about the American National thread, the unified system that includes the three classes, and then the thread fit classifications. Talk about the application where we would use these. And again, the thread designation, nominal size, the number of threads per inch, the class of fit, and again, UNC is Unified National Course. This is a test question, by the way. Thread forms. Another test question. Thread nomenclature. Taps, plug tap, taper tap, bottoming tap. Tap drill sizes. Again, we also have a chart how the machinist handbook for this. And how do we inspect it? I do have a thread micrometer out there. And we've actually practiced doing thread wires. I have those also. And again, they can see the difficulty in reference to using the thread wires. Go gauges, screw pitch gauge, and then the thread gauge itself. And they also have these go and no go. And just checking with a stare rule, the number of threads per inch versus the screw pitch gauge. Standard sizes, major diameter, minor diameter, your pitch diameter. I do believe we chased a 3/16 out there in the lab. And a quarter, 1/2/13. Okay. Then we get into milling. And again, you got milling and machining centers video.
Holes there, and it's hard.
And again, it just shows the various operations, milling. Pretty good video. Okay, and we talked about the milling itself, the process, advantages of the removing the material by the milling. Talk about the various components, the yoke, gang milling, the arbor. Various type milling machines, bed type. Horizontal column and knee. Again, here's where I start talking about the axis, X, Y, and Z axis. Good old bridge porch. We have four. Two NC machines. Again, universal horizontal milling machine. Talk a little bit about the setup, the arbor, the cutter itself, the key. And the milling operation. So again, each one of these, there's a slab milling, face milling, and then end milling. Pretty good videos. Milling cutters. And just about every one of them, I have an example in our lab, a company I used to work for. Some more? Dexable inserts. Operations. Tool holders, shelving mills. They see these out on a CNC machine. And again, the operations themselves. Straddle milling, circular milling, slotting or slitting. And conventional versus climb. And the advantages or disadvantages of either one. This is another test question. Various operations. And they have an issue between a shaper and a planer. And again, I have videos to show them the differences between the two. You don't really see many shapers out there in the industry anymore. Job shop operations may have one. And a big planer. talk about the advantages, disadvantages of each one. And again, there's your shaper. I know if I owned a small machine shop, I'd have one. And here we talk about the vertical shaper operations, mainly to cut keyways, things like that, for slaughter. Ram goes up and down. Have a rotating table. And again, fundamentals of grinding. Then I talked a little bit about grinding and a little bit more about measurement. And let's watch a little bit of the grinding here.
Grinding wheels are extremely fragile and must be handled and stored with care. Wheels should be visually inspected before use. To assure that a wheel isn't cracked, ring test it using a non-metal object. A good wheel will have a clear ringing sound. A cracked wheel will not. If a wheel has been dropped or appears to be damaged, return it to the manufacturer or discard it, but don't use it. Wheel speeds are marked on the wheel or blotter and must not be exceeded. Wheel guards must always be in place before turning on a grinding wheel to avoid injury should the wheel fail. Proper eye protection should always be worn during grinding operations to protect against flying grit and sparks. Proper balance of the grinding wheel is essential to produce high-quality parts. Out-of-balance wheels produce excess vibration, early wheel failure, and can destroy workpiece surface finish. Grinding wheels may be initially balanced on a balance stand. Modern machines are sometimes equipped with an automatic balancing device. With higher wheel speeds, automatic balancing becomes a necessity.
Okay, pretty good little video. And we do have a surface grinder out in the lab. Okay, I found this. I want to share this with you. This is a link for carbide tooling. Let me go to that. I want to copy and paste it here. That's our Edison website, by the way. All right. What I really like about this link, the Carbide Depot, tells you really a lot about tooling. I can get into boring bars. And again, it shows nomenclature, it shows pictures, et cetera, so on and so forth. Carbide burrs, drilling, indexable drilling, end mills, carbide, and again, you can go to each one. Milling cutters. And then holders. So it's a nice little website to go to, tool holders. And again, it talks about the inserts. Again, the various carbide inserts. How to read them. Different nomenclature. So again, you have that link. Okay, here's my lathe projects, my lab projects. First one I'm going to show you, this is a very basic exercise. It's a lathe exercise. They have to turn the three diameters. They have to turn the lengths. And they actually will cut it off and then face it off at 3.5 inches. And they actually, if you notice, they have to drill a drill, or a 1/8 inch diameter drill, 1/2 inch deep. And again, their tolerances, the decimal is plus or minus 1,000, so fractional is plus or minus 1/64. And as I think I mentioned the very first night that when I first started teaching here part-time, I was teaching this, and I had quite a few students didn't know how to read a micrometer, so we end up having a metrology class. But if the transfer engineering students, the degree does not require metrology, I still have to spend a couple hours on metrology instruments, but what we would use, that they have to do this lathe project, and I grade it. That's this is a very basic one. Then I get, this is what it actually looks like. So again, they'll turn, do the drill, and they'll cut it off. All right, we allow this extra stock out here. So when they cut it off, they'll turn it around, they'll check up here, and then they'll face it to the overall length. We talk about burring, chamfering. And there's my other lathe project. And again, this is a meat tenderizer. It's out of aluminum. They'll have a couple of milling operations they need to do. They'll have the taper they'll be doing. They'll have the knurling. And again, chasing the threads. There's the difference of each end as far as alignment and milling. You see there about how deep they go. And again, there's where it's taken apart. So again, they chase these threads, tap these. You keep thinking I'd have them sign a liability statement they can't use it for a weapon. I actually had one gentleman made 4 of these for Christmas for family or whatever. Just looking here, the issue that they have sometimes is cutting the taper, but we use the taper attachment. And then there's milling project that they'll do. Again, I give them the print, give them the stock. They have to hold the sizes, various depths on each side, turn it over, etc. 125 micro finish. And that's what it's looked like. I actually had 2 different sizes. Another one. A little more difficult as far as alignment, doing the angles. We have a swivel vise, that's how they end up doing those. And these are videos for basic CNC, and I put every one of them in this PowerPoint presentation, so you have a link to them. I'm going to go ahead and just start the first one so you can see about what they're like.
Hello, and thank you for watching Basic CNC Programming for the CNC Mill. If you've ever stood in front of a computer screen or a CNC mill and you watched a program run and you wondered what it all means, the X's and the Y's and the G's and the M's, then study out these next few videos where I'll explain what it all means. So if that's of interest to you, And I'm going to go into the very basics of how a program is put together and where it all starts. So let's get your pen and paper out and let's get started. All right, so let's talk about the Cartesian coordinate system and how it relates to CNC programming. All right, as you can see, I have drawn two axes here, a horizontal axis being the x-axis and a vertical line being the y-axis. Now, there are points infinitely on these x-axis in either direction and also on the y-axis. And of course, also away from these axes, anywhere in this space. Now, what we need to learn today is depending on what direction we find these points, we'll either...
Okay, that's just really basic CNC. I do lecture prior to getting into that. And then as I go through here, you'll see the rest of the videos. Here's one, the basics of a cutter path. Talk about toolpath. Then the next one talks about how to code straight lines and clockwise arcs, which is a G code. G2's clockwise, G3's counterclockwise. Straight path is one. And we talk about, again, the G code's explained. Again, all these are videos. Same gentleman. They're actually better than that first one. And here's climb milling versus conventional milling. And see CNC program. We can watch a little bit of that one real quick.
All right, welcome to lesson five of basic CNC programming for the CNC mill. In this lesson, we'll be talking about the difference between climb cutting and conventional cutting. In previous examples, I've always walked the end mill around the part in a clockwise motion, and I told you that there was a particular reason for that, and we'll be discussing that in this lesson. So, as you see, we walked around this part clockwise, and that would be considered climb milling versus this illustration here where the end mill walks around in a counterclockwise motion. The machine can be programmed to do either, and it will do exactly as you tell it to. The only difference will be is the amount of power it takes to drive your end mill around.
Okay, so again, it talks a little bit about the advantages. Cutter compensation. A little bit more advanced CNC. Tool offsets. Work offsets. Mill radiuses, the I's and J's, which is the internal radius. Show you a little bit of that one.
And welcome back to lesson 8 of basic CNC programming. In this lesson, we're going to be talking about plane selection and I's and J's. Now, when you look at the top of the program, we have what's called a safety line right here. And on that safety line, you will see the G17. The G17 is a XY plane selection, and that works hand in hand with the I's and J's that you'll see. So now let's talk about what I's and J's are and what planes are. So let's look at an illustration where we'll see three possible plane selections. All right, so we've learned about the x-axis and the y-axis making up the xy plane, flat plane, which the machine knows as a G17 plane. So the machine now knows that any geometry picked in that plane, the tool is perpendicular to that surface. Another reason why we need to know the plane selection is because when the tool produces an arc, it needs to know the I and J value of that arc, and we're going to learn about that in the next illustration. Now, there are two more plane selections that we need to learn about, and that is the G18 plane, which is the X and Z, and then also the G19 plane, which is the Y and Z. Now, in the G18, we used I's in K's. In the G19, we used J and K's to swing a radius. Now, let me make it a little bit more clear how these planes are oriented to each other. So hopefully this helps. You can see here the red plane is the plane that we've been.
Okay, so again, just basic CNC programming. As I said, I made a comment. My son teaches high school in Greenville, and they just actually got a small CNC machine. And I like to have that out there in my lab. All right. So again, cutting the radiuses.
And welcome.
Absolute incremental mode. The difference between those. Common M codes, machining codes. Turn coolant on, turn coolant off, tool change, etc. in your CNC program. And drilling and tapping, CAN cycles. We actually did this out there today. The advantages of a CAN cycle. Okay. Then we'll finish up. We talk about, we turn local manufacturing companies in the Rubik. And in so doing, what we're trying to do is give them some visual exposure of what's happening out there. My field trip, I go to Mr. Machine. We go to Mr. Machine, they'll see a really large, heavy equipment, horizontal boring mills, the planer mills, the grinders, the lathes, etc. In the trip, we go through the foundry, as I mentioned before. And generally, Mr. Machine is very cooperative when we get there. We get there mainly in probably about 6 o'clock. And they will wait to pour when we get there. So they get actually see the sparks and everything fly. So that's pretty interesting. And again, you know, some of the machining. And we also go through their weld lab. So they're welding. They do very large equipment. They have a welding position. I think it is huge. I think maybe it's 15 feet or 20 feet square. But again, they see this type of operations and very cooperative. It takes about 2.5 hours to go through, but it's definitely worth the trip. Another field trip that I end up doing here in town, we have Piqua Emery Foundry, which is just a small job shop type foundry. They do everything sand. And again, these are the various parts that they make. So they'll see when they go in there, number one, a lot of dirt and the various people, you know, the various operations, the exact same thing that we do out in the lab. So they get exposure to that. And then the company I used to work for, this gentleman right here actually took my place. It took him 15 years to hire somebody, but this is out in the machine shop at French Oil Mill Machining Company here in town. Tom Wyatt is over the tool crib. These are, I believe, high school students is coming through. And they end up making compression presses. And this talks about rebuilding before and after, but they make new compression presses. They make fiber presses, and again, I call these in a way like big meat grinders, where they'll remove liquids from wood pulp, paper recycling industries, and polymer equipment. And again, we talk about gearboxes, et cetera, alignment, how we inspect those. These cages, there's actually a shaft going through here, and there's a screw that pulls the rubber through and squeezes the water out of the rubber. Goes down through a trough, and the rubber goes to another location. This out here at the end is called a pelletizer. If you've ever bought plastic pellets, this is the same thing this thing does out here at the end, and it has little rubber pellets. So they actually get to see these operations or these machines when we go to French Oil. And there's my contact information. And I trust that we have covered what we need to cover, Rob. For the manufacturing CTAG.
Steve, this is Mark Jackson.
Yes.
Thank you so much for doing this for us. A lot of good information.
Well, you're welcome. And again, if anybody, I'm not sure where your schools are at, but if you'd like a field trip, just contact me and we'll get you through. If we have time, we'll end up forecasting.
No, that's great. Yeah, I really appreciate it.
Okay, you're welcome.
Yeah, I'd like to thank you too, Steve. We don't do anything near the manufacturing processes that you have, but a lot of your slides, I'm going to steal some of the stuff off of them, give the kids a little bit more. And I think I may contact you for a field trip to come out and just let some students see some of the basic stuff that's going on, because here we have no shops. So we're okay. Pretty laid into small type of processes, and we don't even try to CTAG this course. But I think it's still good for them to get a background on it because of the other engineering work that they do.
Okay. Yeah, feel free. Like I say, depending on the time, I take you through. We'll talk a little bit. Matter of fact, the next slide that I have, there's my information. That's Edison's website. You go to edisonohio.cbu, it's up there at the top. If you go over here and hit resources, it will go to the catalog, and we'll talk about programs available. And again, the engineering programs we have, if you go in there, we'll see advanced manufacturing, the design, the transfer degree, and then also electronics.
Okay. And again, thank you.
You're welcome.
This has really been wonderful, and thanks very much. And to Mark and Ted, thanks to both of you for, you know, sticking it out with this, with all these workshops. And we're hoping to do something in CAD after the first of the year. We didn't want to try to fit something in between Thanksgiving and Christmas here. But I think we'll get emails out to everybody. But I think it's going to be scheduled like the beginning, maybe the second or third week in January. Same kind of model. A guy from Columbus State is going to do that. He's a really neat guy. Got a lot of good ideas on projects and stuff.
And again, feel free to contact me if you have any questions. And again, that's what this material is for. Use it.
Yeah.
So I guess I can say happy holidays. Enjoy your Thanksgiving. And I'm going to give you a little bit of time off here.